We want to welcome Charlie Meek tonight. Charlie is coming and playing the dulcimer for us. And Charlie's well known around this area. He lives in the Ozark National Forest. What a great place to live. All surrounded by the woods and hills. Charlie, come. We look forward to hearing you tonight.
We're doing something different tonight. This is a mountain dulcimer. Can I get this? Yeah, there it goes. Some of you are familiar with it, but a lot of people, I guess, aren't. They ask me what it is. I play around town and so on. It's an interesting instrument. It's a definite folk instrument. It's one of the two instruments that was developed right here in North America. The other one is the autoharp, which was developed by a music teacher to help him teach chords. But this is in response to the people in the southern Appalachians about 250, 300 years ago, to have an instrument that they could build at the house, that they could play very easily, and it would accompany singing. The original ones didn't have fancy curves like this. They were just boxes, and they had three strings, and they didn't even fret all the way across. The only frets were right here on this melody string. So the only thing they could play was the melody. And these two strings right here just groaned. They couldn't even make any chords on it. But it was fine. They could use it, build it at the house, simple to build, simple to play, and accompany singing. You might notice, if you're familiar with most musical instruments, most string instruments, that there's a lot of frets missing on this instrument. Just a few frets. What you have here is the white keys on the piano. The one exception, we got one black key down here. So it's do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do is what it is. Which means anybody can play it. I could teach anyone here to play a tune on the dulcimer in about 3 or 4 minutes. If you can go do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, you can play the dulcimer. So it answered a critical need for a musical instrument they could build at the house, was easy to play, and didn't cost a lot of money like some of the guitars and so on. Now the original ones were tuned in what is known to the intellectual crowd as Ionian tuning, the rest of us old-time dulcimer tuning. Since we're missing a lot of these intermediate frets, we can't do a chromatic scale, we can't do the sharps and flats, so they're designed to play only in one key at a time. In this particular case, this is tuned to D. I'm going to go ahead and play a number for you right now. This is in the old-time dulcimer tuning, and it's going to sound an awful lot. Wait till the race has stopped. It's going to sound an awful lot like the original dulcimers probably sounded on the front porch of an old cabin up in the Appalachian Mountains 250 or 300 years ago. It has an interesting sound. This would be a very simple sound. Keep in mind, this was something that was easy to play and didn't require any musical training. They would generally pick up something like a turkey feather or something of that nature. Southern Appalachians several hundred years ago. Well, of course, there are always those who want to change things a little bit, make them a little bit better. And so recently, relatively recently, people have started putting the frets all the way across the dulcimer, as you see on this one. That means that you can chord, you can make chords with the dulcimer, which you couldn't do before with the frets just on the melody string. So you can chord the thing, you can do a lot more with it. They found that in this old dulcimer or Ionian tuning, it's very hard to do chords, so they changed the tuning to another modal tuning, again for the intellectuals among you, the Mixolydian, or for the rest of us, the new dulcimer tuning. It has a little brighter sound, not quite as dark a sound as the old tuning, but you can do a lot more with it. I'll play a number for you now with it, and you can get an idea of what the new tuning sounds like. Possum of the Gumstone. What can be done can be overdone, and some of us in this modern electrical age have found a way to install a pickup in the dulcimer and run it through the amp system. What that does, the dulcimer is a very soft instrument when it's finger picked. You almost can't hear it. So by putting the pickup in the instrument, I can now finger pick it. You can actually hear what I play. That might be a good idea or a bad idea, whatever. This is a baritone dulcimer. It's tuned a little lower than the others, and I think it sounds a little better finger picked. I really enjoy playing the old Celtic songs, the songs of Ireland and Scotland, which are the basis for so much of the music that you hear up on this stage. Most of them were played originally on the Celtic harp, and I've tried to come as close as I can to duplicating that sound.
switch dulcimers now. And someone mentioned a waltz earlier. Let's try a little waltz on this. This is one of my favorites. It's called, from Texas, called Midnight on the Waters. And if any of you would like to come up, here's the dance floor. Please make yourself at home. Another one on this strum dulcimer here. It's kind of a fun song. It's called Okeechobee Grass. Thing. It's a living thing, really. It changes over time. A lot of the folk music wasn't written down for hundreds of years, and it kind of ebbs and flows with the times. I think a great example, kind of a fun thing, is a song that was originally about William Kidd, better known as Captain Kidd the Pirate. He was captured in New York around the year 1700. They shipped him off to London, England, found and tried him for piracy, found him guilty, and they hung him. But in that year, 1700, there was a song made up about him and the evils of piracy, which evidently was fairly popular in England. I don't normally sing, I have to tell you, unless something just irritates me. But
but I'll try a verse of this just for illustrative purpose. It went something like this. My name is Captain Kidd when I sailed, and evil deeds I did when I sailed. And it went on to describe his life of evil and finally swinging from the gibbet in London in the year 1701. Well, 150 years later in Ireland, they were going through the dark times. Potato famine had struck, and people were starving to death. Well, the Irish will make a song about anything. They loved the tune, so they used that tune, just borrowed it, and put new words to it. Now, in Ireland, potatoes are pronounced praties, and the song became, the praties, they grow small over here, and we eat them skins and all over here. About the potato famine. Well, now it gets interesting. A song made it to the United States. There's a group of singers over here, primarily in the Primitive Baptist Church. And they sang a beautiful four-part a cappella harmony called Shake Notes or Sacred Harp Singing. Just beautiful. You can still hear some of it today. Well, they loved the melody, but they sure didn't want to sing about hanging a pirate or starving to death. So now, for the third time, we get new words, same melody. What wondrous love is this, oh my soul, what wondrous love is this, oh my soul. And if you look today in the Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, or Catholic hymnal, you'll find the song, What Wondrous Love Is This, the original melody for which was written in a song about hanging Captain Kidd the pirate in the year 1700. Isn't that amazing? Because it's such a pretty song. So here we have a song that's made it 900 years. A lot of people think they, Simon and Garfunkel wrote it. Nope, they borrowed it. But it's, the reason it's still around is because it's such a beautiful tune. Let me see if I can do it for you. There's no monitor up here, so I don't know whether I'm playing too loud or too soft. I hope you can hear it. Two more songs? Got you covered. Okay. Let's see. Switch Dulcimers. During the Civil War, there was a particular song which became popular, a train song called Reuben's Train. After the war and right on through the 1880s and 1890s, there were some things changed about it as folk will happen to folk music. Some of the words changed, and it became still a train song, but the song 900 Miles. And that's the way it stayed until the early 1960s, when a Georgia folk singer, Hetty Green, got hold of it. And she changed it again, changed some of the words and a few of the notes, and it became the song 500 Miles. And everybody, of course, has heard, I think everybody's recorded 500 Miles. I'd like to play for you right now the middle one, 900 Miles. But before I do, I have to warn you that it's just a little bit longer than 500 miles. That's pretty lame, I know, but it's the only thing I could think of at the time. Prohibition. Slipping you a bottle of White Lightning if you'd like to meet me over there afterwards. No, I don't have that too. I could, I wouldn't admit it. This is a dry, it used to be a dry guy. Okay, the last song. One of my favorites. I hope it's one of yours too. When you're old, you have to look at how you started. You all know how that goes? Thank you very much.